nearly a month away from home. The Eureka basketball team has looked to continue. Wow. Rough start already. It's been a while since we've been at home. But the Eureka Red Devils back in front of home fans here at the Reagan. Spencer Davis, Levi Taylor joining you for this night's edition of Eureka College Basketball. Again, a doubleheader coming at you tonight. First with the women's team facing Fontbonne. And Levi, last time out for the Red Devils again on a four-game losing streak. The last time they won actually was here at home against Blackburn.
Well, as you mentioned, it's been kind of a rough stretch for really both of these teams. They've had a rough season so far. Eureka looking to turn it around here tonight and kind of right the ship here at home. As you mentioned, first time they've been in this building in a while. Hopefully they can shake the rust off and have a good one tonight.
And Fontbonne, again, a rough start to their season. They did not win a game in the 2023 part of this campaign, but winning their first game of 2024, they lost their last one, however. But again, starting to get any sort of momentum going forward into that new year, it'll be interesting to see how they come up against a team like Eureka, who again doesn't have a lot of depth or anything like that. But Bryn Holtz, a new player, a transfer player coming in, really starting to light up the stat sheet.
Yeah, as you mentioned, Bryn Holtz coming in, already making an impact on this team, had 26 in the last game, I believe, is averaging 17 points per game in the games that she has played so far with this team. So she's going to be a key part. And also you got Josie Ness on the team, who's always a big factor in any game.
Levi, keys of the game, what do the Red Devils have to do to get back into the win column tonight?
Well, it's pretty simple, Spencer. Control the ball, have multiple scores. You got to have more than just one or two people that are doing all the scoring. Got to have multiple scores, control the boards, and just control the pace of the game and don't let them control it.
Well, that's all we have on the pregame side of things. Eureka Red Devils versus Fontbonne. On the other side of this, National Anthem starting lineups. Can't wait to bring it to you right here on ACTV.
St. Jude affects all corners of the world for good. I mean, if you think about organizations that affect an entire world, it's a short list. Taking care of kids is a priority. Taking care of the families as whole.
Without donations, without people that care for St. Jude and for the kids of St. Jude, our max wouldn't be here.
You are making a difference, not just in a hospital, but in an entire world.
When people ask us who we are, we tell them we're problem solvers, opportunity creators, community builders, and change makers. We are Rotary. Around the world, our network of 1.4 million neighbors, friends, and leaders volunteer their skills, expertise, and resources to solve issues and address community needs. We are people of action. Join us, and together, we can make an even greater impact. Find out how you can get involved at rotary.org/action.
For a child you loved, to make their wish come true, to help them fight a critical illness. Just imagine what you'd do. Every single one of us can make the stars align, because when we come together, hope and joy will shine.
Send it down to Ethan Hedge, who has the starting lineups.
Now let's meet tonight's starting lineups. First, for the visiting Fontbonne Griffins, a junior from St. Louis, Missouri, number 3, Jamise Bailey, and a senior from Sullivan, Missouri, number 10, Kaya Harbor, a sophomore from St. Louis, Missouri, number 12, Hannah Myers, and a senior from Greenville, Illinois, number 22, Riley Pickett, and a senior from St. Louis, Missouri, number 32, Amaya Earl. And now, the starting lineup for your Eureka Red Devils! Introducing first, a senior from Wayne City, Illinois, number 3, Avery Seidel. And a freshman from Hudson, Illinois, number 14, Ashley Wilcox. And a senior from Mahomet, Illinois, number 24, Michaela Rosenberry. And a junior from Quincy, Illinois, number 32, Bryn Holtz. And a junior from Sandwich, Illinois, number 33, Josie Ness. The Red Devils are coached by Mike Hedrick and assisted by Elijah Donnelly and Franny Heckman.
And before things get too further along, we want to give a quick shout-out to Katie Eaton. Katie Eaton Bain just joined the SLIAC Hall of Fame. Again, the all-time leading scorer in women's basketball history in the conference. So we want to extend our congratulations to her graduating in 2012 from Eureka College. But again, one of obviously our program leader in points, if she's the conference leader all time in points as well. But congratulations to her. We'll see if the current edition of the Red Devils can bring home a win on a pretty special day. It'll be Rosenberry to jump, and winning the jump, Wilcox will control. And the Red Devils, again, back in front of their home fans for the first time in, again, almost a full month. A lot of road trips, and we'll see what Seidel can do on her trip to the basket, blocked there early. Credit that to Kaya Harbor.
Well, you talked about this being their first game in a month, and you know that home court advantage may not be as strong tonight with them not being on this floor in so long to play a game.
Fontbon working it around into the corner. So with Bailey. Bailey the leading scorer to the corner. Now with Myers. Three-pointer up. Earl's too strong. Offensive rebound. Fontbon another chance and in. Hannah Myers.
Well, Eureka starting off this game in a man-to-man defense. Sometimes we see him play that 2-3 zone, but tonight starting off in the man-to-man, we'll see how they match up against these Fontbon Griffins.
Again, this is our first time seeing Bryn Holtz in action. Again, joined the team at the end of the first semester. And again, like you said, leading the team in scoring so far, 6-foot guard. It's nice to have out there.
Yeah, having a 6-foot guard, especially in women's basketball, is huge to have. That's a very, very big guard. And we'll see how she does tonight on the home floor.
Wilcox blocked. Red Devils still looking for their first bucket. Fontbon looking for their second on this trip. We pick it to set things up on the left side. Now with Earls. Myers. Pickett thinking about a three. Drives instead. 13 on the shot clock. There's that 2-3 zone that you talked about, Levi. That shot blocked by Holtz. Blocked again by Rosenberry and Ness. And Ness comes up with it.
Well, Josie Ness, just we see her do that all the time, using her size down low to create defense and hopefully creating some offense.
And it's not like Ness has an unreal vertical or anything like that. Just good positioning most of the time. Holtz flinging up a three. Batted around. Ness keeps it in bounds. Still on the floor. Seidel trying to go for it. Pickett hands it off. Knocked out of the hands of Earls. Holtz trapped in the corner. Kick back out. Rosenberry. Plenty of time on the shot clock to set things up. Seidel, the senior, to the corner. Rosenberry. It's Holtz getting double-teamed early. Mid-range J from her, yes.
Well, Eureka did a much better job of moving the ball in that possession. Their first couple of possessions looked a little rushed, looked like they were out of sorts a little bit. Good job moving the ball there and finding the open basket.
Fontbon playing with a little pace, deep three up, and knocked in there by Jamise Bailey.
Well, they're in that 2-3 zone, so both guards are back. They've got to communicate up top on which one is going to take the ball handler and have a hand in the face.
7:30 remaining in the first quarter. Just underway back in Eureka, Illinois. Wilcox, Holtz, corner shot there, no good. It's Ness and Earls knocking it out of bounds. Let's say it was Ness touching it last.
We talked about Holtz just now coming to the team. She is not shy to shoot the basketball. A few shots her early on in the game. And, you know, she's become one of the leading scorers on this team in her first few games. So I'm sure that Coach Hedrick is not upset to see her put up those shots.
It's a blocking foul in front of the scorer's table. It's Ness's first, and Levi, she fouled out in the last game. Probably not where you want to see her picking up a foul.
Yeah, I mean, that's just a foul away from the basket. Really not where she usually collects the fouls. We see her in foul trouble several times this year, and it's going to need to keep her out of foul trouble tonight.
Rosenberry with a steal and bucket. Something we've gotten very accustomed to seeing. Red Devils in a press as well. A little malfunction with the shot clock there, it seems. A couple ticks under seven.
And if you've been tuning in all year, that is a sight that you're probably used to, is shot clock malfunctions.
Happens to the best of us. You know, this is the first game for them in a month as well here. You know, you got to get used to the controls again. And
yeah, everybody's shaking off the rust here. I mean, we had to shake off the rust here at the start. We're still kind of shaking off the rust. Just got to settle back into a groove of basketball here.
It's nice to be back, though. Again, no better way to start with the doubleheader. Red Devils is seventh place in the conference right now. So a win here against Fontbonne. Get some momentum going with the conference slate really in full swing at this point. Definitely some technical issues over there. Usually gets resolved pretty quick, but now all the clocks are all blinking at us. Got it down to 27. Everyone ready to go once again. It'll be Jamise Bailey up the floor quickly to Harbor. Fontbonne not looking to really play in a set offense too much. It's really quickly up the floor every possession. Earls at the elbow, 12 on the shot clock. Earls guarded by Ness, backdoor cut, deflected. Top of the key. Dump off pass, shot up with one on the shot clock and a miss.
Really good defensive set there from the Red Devils. A lot of really good communication. You can hear them talking on the floor, and that's what they need every time down the floor.
Holtz to the corner. Ness now controlling. Ness having already won Slide Player of the Week at one point in the season. Shot missed there. Earls rebounds. Don't always see this, but the Red Devils just in an immediate one-to-one press. Fontbonne setting up their offense with Bailey. What a Harbor.
They're putting a lot of pressure on Fontbonne's ball handlers, trying to make them make mistakes and turn the ball over.
High shot from Pickett goes down. Thought for a minute, I mean, it's a little perspective is a little skewed, but it looked like it was going to touch the banners how high up it was. Holtz quick fire three, rattles out, Ness can't control. Pickett will bring it up, having just hit the three. It's Bailey trying her hand once again. That one knocked in. Hot start from three for the Griffins.
Red Devils got caught in transition there. Didn't quite rotate fast enough. Had a wide open shot. And all of their three, Spencer, have been wide open. Not a hand in the face. Red Devils are going to need to close out on those.
Wilcox pick and roll. It's Holtz, 12 on the shot clock. Holtz step back inside the arc. Spins one home. Tough shot to make. She's an aggressive shot taker from what we've seen.
Yeah, not afraid to shoot the ball, and she has the ability to score. Kind of had a hard time getting going in this game. Hopefully can start to heat up a little bit.
And travel called. Subs will come in, but we've got our first media timeout at 4:49 remaining in the first quarter of action. Fontbonne leading 11-6 on ECTV.
I immigrated to America when I was 20. From a country called Uruguay. I have two careers. I'm in the Army Reserves, and I have a civilian career as an engineer. And I have two wonderful children. Every day is a challenge to make sure that the time that I have, I spend with them. It doesn't matter how tired you are, you have to be there. You have to be present for them. You have to trying to teach them when they learn something new and it just clicks in their brain. I just realized I could do this. And you can just see in their faces. It's such an incredible moment. It's those moments that are my favorite.
Welcome back inside the Christine Bonatti Bullwinkle Arena. 11-6, our score about halfway through the first quarter. And Eureka's returned to home. They're trying to get back into the win column. It's Ashley Wilcox will bring it up. The Red Devils donning their home grays. Pass gets deflected, still trying to find Ness down low. Katie Hafner onto the floor for the first time for the Red Devils. Seidel, a little shoulder check there. Like Brianna Beamer onto the court for the first time. Also number 14, McKaylee Hopkins for Fontbonne. Getting her first minutes. It's Wilcox, run off the line. Shot clock has not started yet. There it goes. Taken away regardless.
Well, Eureka looks a little bit rushed on offense, as I mentioned earlier. Need to slow down, get into offensive set, and settle into this game.
Wild shot from Hopkins doesn't go in. Wilcox looking to push the pace. Ness, power dribbles, really going to work down there. Through some contact, bucket is good.
Well, we talked about Josie Ness using her size to her advantage and did the same thing right there, using her body to create the open shot.
Again, the Red Devils running a very successful 2-3 zone so far tonight. Runner no good there. Wilcox controlled drive. Here's Ness, double team, kicks out. Wilcox swung. Seidel, three-pointer up from her. Too strong, and a rebound from Pickett.
It was a good swing pass from Wilcox, just unfortunately unable to knock the shot down.
Floating out to the corner. Fontbonne. Left-handed scoop, no good. Miss there from Beamer. Rosenberry bounce pass off the shin of Ness. Ness diving for it. And our first tie-up of the game.
Well, it was the right idea from Rosenberry. I just think that she passed the ball a little too early. Probably could have gotten deeper into the lane, made the defender commit, and then would have had Ness wide open for a layup.
It's always a really tough pass to complete, too, when you're in the middle of the floor and somebody's just a few feet in front of you and trying to contort yourself to catch behind. But again, Red Devils only trailing by three here early on. It's Fontbonne on offense, Pickett from three in the same spot she hit earlier, doesn't hit that time. 3 minutes to go in the first, 11-8. It's Ashley Wilcox. Getting a screen from Holtz. It's Hafner. 13 on the shot clock. Hafner, crossover. And jump ball is the call. Official looked like he got caught in between a few different motions on that.
I think they changed the call to a jump ball.
Yeah, I believe that was... It looked like initially he was going to call a travel, but yes, it did overturn his own call with the jump ball. Ariel Chisholm coming onto the floor. Full night of basketball ahead. The women's Red Devils taking on Fontbonne, and then the men's team will take on Fontbonne as well at about 7:30. Three on the shot clock. Holtz. Couple jab steps, launches one up, does not touch rim anyway. We've seen some really good defensive possessions from both teams, late shots into the shot clock.
Yeah, I think part of that is both offenses are kind of in a hurry, and maybe the nerves are getting to them a little bit, maybe a little bit antsy. You know, play Christmas break is a tough time to play basketball because you're kind of out of your rhythm and routine. So could be playing a factor here in this game.
It's Hopkins, cross-court, Pickett. It's Bailey looking to drive to the corner. Three-pointer up, Beamer. No good, Ness with another rebound. Wilcox, quick outlet. Hafner knocked out of her hands. Should stay with the Red Devils. And they're saying it went off of Hafner. Earl's back onto the court for Fontbonne. Certainly looked like Coach Hedrick was having a couple of words with one of the officials. A quick foul there for Lainey Moore. Onto the court for the first time and wasted no time. One of the more aggressive defenders the Red Devils have.
Yeah, we see her pressuring the ball handler a lot when she's in the game. lot of times have her pressing, really. There's a lot of times we've seen her full court press by herself just on the ball handler.
1:50 left, and there's a foul on the perimeter by Hafner. But Levi, I think the Red Devils are just going to have to adjust to the fact that it's getting called tighter on the perimeter.
Yeah, they are calling it very tight on the perimeter, and they're just going to have to be careful, play defense with your feet, stay in front of your defender, don't be reaching, stay out of foul trouble.
Red Devils at three team fouls, two away from the bonus. Back into the corner, three-pointer up. Too strong there from Myers. Moore trying to push it up. Good kind of box out there from Hopkins to keep Moore away from it. Harbor bring it up. It's Hopkins once again. Sizing up Wilcox, trying to get to the bucket. Misses the shot there. Wilcox giving a lane, looking to go all the way. Can't finish there. Earls rebounds.
Well, it was the right idea. She had an open lane to the basket, just unable to get it to go. And, you know, I feel like we say that a lot with the Red Devils' offense is that they're getting open shots. They're creating ball movement, creating space, doing the right things, but just not able to get it to go down.
Minute, 6 seconds left in the first quarter. It's Brenna Langenberg onto the court for the first time for Fontbonne. It's Brianna Beamer getting called for a foul. Again, one of those kind of unforced turnovers. Fontbonne was just trying to bring the ball up and not as technically sound screen as you'd want. Ness, a little too aggressive on the glass. That's her second foul of the first quarter.
And as we mentioned, we see her getting into foul trouble quite a bit. I mean, she creates a lot of attention, so she's going to create more foul calls for herself. It's not necessarily anything that she's doing wrong. She's just somebody that they're going to watch on the floor.
18 on the shot clock for Fontbonne. It's Hopkins. No Nevaeh Essien tonight. Three-pointer up from Myers. Way too strong, and Seidel could not bring it in. Tough play there. With the ball going that quickly, doesn't touch rim. Probably think it does. It was a pretty low shot.
Yeah, it can mess with you a little bit because sometimes it's hard to tell when you're under the basket whether it is going to hit the rim or not. Sometimes it can surprise you and get up on you real quick if it doesn't.
Jammed plenty of fingers before on something like that. Fortunately, it didn't sound like there was one. You can usually tell by the rather grotesque sound that it makes when you jam a finger. Langenberg into the corner. Three-pointer up from Hopkins. No good. Knocked out of the hands by Langenberg. Red Devils will retain possession. Shot clock should turn off. Red Devils will have a chance for the last shot. Both teams well below their scoring averages so far this season. Seidel really having some problems bringing up the floor. Tolt's quick fire three. Knocked in. Tied up at 11.
Well, we mentioned earlier, she's not afraid to shoot the ball. Definitely not shy.
Hopkins colliding. Holtz with a block. Last shot of the quarter goes in. Hannah Myers to close out the first.
Well, just an unlucky bounce really rolled out to her. Had a wide open shot. Red Devils didn't play bad defense there. Just, as I said, an unfortunate bounce.
14-11 the score at the end of the first quarter. Fontbonne leading Eureka.
Things running for those who rely on us. That's why we don't have time to be sick with the flu.
We don't have time for delays.
Ready!
We don't have time for spills.
Next!
We don't have time for setbacks. Let's be real.
Getting the flu shot
helps you fight the flu.
Get a flu shot for yourself and those around you too.
Last week, Brandon met a girl on a dating app. One day after work, he finally found the courage to ask her out. No answer. He started to panic. Was he being too pushy? Maybe it was too...
Hey, sorry I didn't respond. I was driving.
I would love to go on a date. How does tonight sound?
Brandon tried to play it cool, but inside he knew a girl so smart, so responsible, she must be a keeper.
14-11 as the teams take the floor. Once again, Fontbonne leading. It appears to be the seventh game each. These two SLAC members. Fontbonne 1-5 so far in conference play. The Red Devils 2-4. It's been a tight matchup so far. Levi was a three-pointer at the very end of that first quarter to put Fontbonne back in front. But again, 14-11, not a lot of scoring.
No, not a lot of scoring. As I mentioned, it looks like both offenses are a little bit out of rhythm. Excuse me. Can't get shots to go down. Can't really get their offense moving. We'll see how the second quarter turns out and see if it turns around a little bit.
Langenberg run off the three-point line. Hop step around Holtz. Finishes with the floater. Certainly seems like Fontbonne settling into their offense quickly. It's Wilcox all the way to the bucket. Misses the scoop shot. Tipped off the hands of Langenberg.
Well, you talked about Fontbonne getting into rhythm on offense. That three-pointer at the end of the first quarter at the buzzer can really give you a big momentum push and can really start to make things click for your team.
Yeah, kind of an early gut punch there for the Red Devils, tying it up on that late three. Then immediately having to respond. Just Holtz missing a three there. Ness taking off the top of Earl's head. Ness out there with two fouls in that first quarter. Hafner in the corner. Holtz, 8 on the shot clock. Three-pointer up from her. Left short and out of bounds.
Yeah, you mentioned Ness playing with two fouls here early in the second quarter now. She's really got to be careful not to pick up that third one before halftime. You can really put yourself in a hole and miss a lot of playing time on the floor if you get yourself in that position.
The Red Devils, again, not with their usual depth at center. Nevaeh Essien not playing tonight. Three-pointer up and missed, and a rebound for Holtz. There'll be a lot of Ariel Chisholm kind of eating those minutes where Ness isn't out on the floor. A lot of Katie Hafner, I would imagine, as well. Ness down low, free run at the bucket.
Good little touch pass there to get the open layup. Ness got on the backside of her defender and used her body really well to get position to get that open layup.
A little stoppage there. The officials thought Coach Hedrick wanted a timeout. He didn't really realize what was going on. Bench was saying, no, we don't want one. Langenberg into the corner. Up top, worked around. Pickett, three-pointer. Thought about, drives through. Holtz draws the charge. Looked like Coach Hedrick called that before the officials did.
Yeah, I mean, well, he's a little bit biased, but he knew right away what the call was going to be.
It's a pretty easy one. It seems like it kind of happened in slow motion. Saw Holtz set up well before that drive, and Levi is a ball handler. When you see that happen, what is your first thought?
Well, there's not really a whole lot you can do once you're committed. You just kind of got to, you can try to move around him, but most times you're not going to be able to. You just kind of got to go through him and just let the officials call what they're going to call.
Red Devils back within one. Pass got tipped by Rosenberry. It's Bailey to the corner. Three-pointer up from Pickett this time. Too strong. Rebound for Ness. Langenberg trying to stay in front of Wilcox. They'll get a hand check there on the perimeter. Still on the floor. Both teams, again, within striking distance of each other. It's been a close game back and forth. And really, Levi, what's been the difference for Fontbonne? Just timelier shots, I guess?
Yeah, I mean, as we mentioned, they had the late bucket at the end of the first quarter that went down, and that's really the difference in this game so far. If you take it away, Eureka's winning. As there's a made shot from Holtz. But Eureka kind of slow on offense, looking to settle in still, and hopefully they can start to get some shots fall because they're getting open looks and they're moving the ball fairly well.
Great find from Harbor to Pickett. Just a little too much mustard on that shot. She'll get two free throws anyway, but I'm sure Fontbonne and Riley Pickett especially would have liked to see that go down for a chance for three.
Well, Eureka needs to do a better job of getting back and getting position immediately on defense because it was a wide open pass there. It really would have been a wide open layup had it not been for the foul.
And that can be the issue with running that 2-3 zone. If you're not looking behind you every once in a while, that kind of sneaky backdoor cut can work out. 2 for 2 on that trip. Fontbonne back in front, 18-17. Holtz, pull-up three-pointer from her. Too strong, Seidel with an offensive rebound. Shot clock off at one end, on the other, 15 seconds. Seidel on the right wing. Langenberg poking it loose. Outletted back out to Red Devils. Good transition defense so far. Langenberg back out. Bailey, Earls. Harbor into the corner, Pickett. Opposite corner, Langenberg, three-pointer, too strong. Ends up working out as a pass, though. Earls able to find Langenberg. Good find and finish.
Fonbon doing a really good job moving the ball, being aggressive on offense, being aggressive on defense with their hands. We've seen them block several shots, get several steals, and really creating offense for themselves.
Holtz filling it up again. 11 points from her already. Not even halfway through the second quarter. Rosenberry with a steal. Rosenberry able to split the defense. Foul committed, though, before the shot went up. Again, we talked about it from the difference in last year's play from Michaela Rosenberry to this year's. Her defensive intensity is why she's out there, and it's leading to a lot of points for her.
Yeah, she's really been aggressive on defense. Does a great job of picking off passes and reading it and cheating it. She's done a great job so far this year on defense, and it really creates a lot of offense for the Red Devils when she is active on defense and aggressive.
Rosenberry to inbound here, Seidel. Back out. Wilcox, three-pointer up from her, and a travel. And Levi, we see that a lot. It's that extra gather step, that hop step, if you will. It's starting to get called a lot more.
Yeah, a lot of times you see people get away with it, the little bunny hop, but that time, unfortunately, wasn't able to.
Fonbon able to break the press. Here's Bailey and a walk. Both teams exchanging turnovers. Still in the holiday spirit. Gift of giving. 20-19, Fonbon up. 6:03 left. The first half action. Ariel Chisholm to Wilcox. Outside, three-pointer up from Seidel. High shot there off the backboard. And whistle didn't go, but that is a foul on Josie Ness. That is also her third foul.
I'm going to be completely honest. I don't really understand the foul call there. Spencer, it didn't really look like she... I didn't even think she touched her, but nevertheless, it's a foul call, and it's going to be her third one in this first half. And as I mentioned earlier, she needed to avoid getting that third one before halftime, and it's really unfortunate that it came on that call.
And it seemed like that earlier play with Earls where she kind of really looked like there was a lot more contact and went over, but yeah, on that one, it certainly didn't look like a lot of contact, but again, I guess by that logic, she deserved three at some point, but Red Devils will have to do without her for the better part of this first half. Now, Earls. Hopkins trying to go baseline. Good defense from Hafner and draws a charge.
Well, really good positioning on that baseline. My coach used to tell me when I was in high school, really not legal, but if somebody's driving baseline on you, just put your foot on the out-of-bounds line and make them go through you because you're using it as an extra defender. You're not supposed to do that, but Katie Hafner got away with it right there.
Wilcox to Chisholm, mid-range shot from her goes in, and the Red Devils back in front. Langenberg, Red Devil press, and a carry. I believe that'll take us to our media timeout in the second quarter as well, and it will, 21-20. Red Devils in front, 4:58 remaining in the first half. Red Devil basketball on ECTV.
Well, you're not. Being a part of the different activities and organizations that I've been a part of, I'm actually able to see myself where I'm like, hey, I actually can make a change. I'm one person that can make a difference.
Division III has helped me to develop teamwork skills, critical thinking skills, time management skills.
It's not just about basketball or it's not just about school. It's about developing yourself as a person altogether.
When I was 10, my mom got deported. We had a difficult time, and I feel that's why I didn't get to finish school.
My husband is really supportive in a way that he pushed me to go back to school.
She wants to have a career so her kids can look up to her.
They both keep me motivated to go to school, and they see that if I do it, like, they can do it too, you know? I feel that everything's possible.
Find free adult education classes near you at finishyourdiploma.org.
Red Devils breaking huddle under first-year head coach Mike Hedrick. Off to a 4-9 start so far in the season. And Levi, I mean, with getting the job 2 weeks before your season starts, that's pretty commendable.
Yeah, we've talked about that several times this year when we've been calling the women's games. Just an impressive job so far. I mean, coming in and having to learn your players within 2 weeks of the season and then having the success that he's having so far is very impressive.
15 on the shot clock. Ashley Wilcox, Delaney Moore. Moore looking to go left. Floater up with the left hand. Can't get it. Gets her own miss. Power dribble up. Misses that shot as well, and Hopkins rebounds. Quick break for Fontbonne. It's Bailey going behind the back on Hafner. Scoop shot. Bucket is good. Fontbonne back in front, 22-21 after the bucket from Jamise Bailey.
Well, Eureka needs to do a better job of getting back in transition defense and getting in position. We've seen several times that they haven't gotten back and either giving up an open shot or having to foul because there is an open shot.
7 points from Bailey tonight. Again, the team's leading scorer on pace for her season average. Comes into this one averaging about 15.5 per game. Moore trying to go down low. Pass might have gotten deflected. Earls collects. Langenberg. Coast to coast. Finishes.
Well, once again, Red Devils just letting a ball handler split two of them for a layup. Got to step up and stop the ball handler. If she's got to go through you, she's got to go through you, but create a foul or something.
Wilcox to Hafner. Hafner, a little rocker step, and a travel. Well, that'll bring the subs back onto the floor. Hannah Myers back on for Fontbonne. Michaela Rosenberry, Josie Ness. Bryn Holtz back on for the Red Devils. Levi, a little surprised to see Josie Ness out there?
Yeah, I mean, maybe a little early, but she's got to be real careful. I mean, picking up your fourth foul in the first half would be very detrimental to not only her playing time, but also the team, because they need her on the floor. Very surprised to see her back on the floor in this first half.
Zamaya Earls knocking in that three-pointer. First points of the night from her. 3:15 left in the first half. It's Wilcox with a screen. And lobbed that pass a little too far out of the reach of Josie Ness.
Well, it was the right idea. Ness had the defender pinned on her backside. The lob was open, just unfortunately led her too far.
Hopkins holding near half court. Fontbonne looking to slow things down a little bit. Down low, Hopkins trying to work on Ness. Earls keeping it alive for a moment. Chisholm. Wilcox back out, Chisholm. Holtz facing up, going to step back, firing from three, left short, a rebound from Bailey. Good hands there to prevent the fast break. Bailey disregards what I said as he goes coast to coast.
Well, Ness was kind of put in a tough position there. Couldn't really do much with the foul trouble that she's in. Didn't want to get her fourth one right there, but another coast to coast bucket for Fontbonne.
Wilcox, turnaround floater missed. Fontbonne turning it into a track meet quickly up the floor. Hopkins down low. Nice find and finish there for Myers. And Coach Hedrick taking a 30-second timeout. 2:02 left in the second quarter. A 32-21 lead now for Fontbonne. And Levi, just what happened there? It was a close game.
Well, as I mentioned, Fontbonne kind of sped the game up a little bit. I mentioned in the pregame that Eureka needed to control the pace of this game, but Fontbonne really starting to speed things up and beating the Red Devils down the floor on defense. and they're not able to get into position. A lot of, as I mentioned, a lot of coast-to-coast buckets for Fonbon, and that was a perfectly run fast break right there. I mean, you just can't really draw it up any better than that. They're doing a great job in the fast break, and the Red Devils having a hard time getting back and getting in position.
2:02 left in the first half of action. Again, our first game of two tonight. The Red Devil men taking on Fonbon at about 7:30. So again, the Red Devils looking to snap win streaks in both matchups tonight. It's a four-game losing streak for the ladies and six-game for the guys. Both teams looking for their first win of the new year. No better place to do it than at home. Red Devil women will have some ground to make up, though. Seidel trapped near half court, able to shovel pass Rosenberry. Nice find to Wilcox, who couldn't bring it in, and now a jump ball will stay with the Red Devils.
Well, Fonbon still staying with their aggressive defense, trying to create offense, trying to create fast breaks by pressuring our ball handlers and trying to create turnovers.
Hafner able to get underneath the basket. She is fouled. Two shots upcoming for the junior. Number 32-21, Fonbon on top. Reducing the lead to 10 on that shot. Hafner, one of the transfers coming in. First season with the Red Devils. 1-for-2 on that trip and a rebound there for Myers. Bailey kicks out. Harbert, now Hopkins. Hopkins mid-range jump shot, too strong. And Hafner able to bring that in. Fonbon bench trying to create some noise, and a foul going the other way. It goes on Wilcox, trying to prevent Fonbon from getting that steal. Bit of a holding call, if you will. Four team fouls on Eureka. Next foul they commit, two shots for free for Fonbon. Fonbon committing another one would send the Red Devils line for two as well. It's Bailey. It's Harbor. Rolls down low, Harbor once again. Hopkins bounce pass, Myers, quick shot over Holtz there.
Really good dish off right there to find the open lady on the low block. Eureka needs to do a better job. I mean, I feel like I'm saying the same thing over and over again. Step up and stop the ball handler.
Seidel's three-pointer no good. And a foul going on Fonbon, and I believe that will be Red Devil free throws upcoming. They attribute it to Hannah Myers. First foul of the night for her. 9 points for her as well. That's Katie Hafner at the free throw line. Just split. 39.7 seconds left. Josie Ness will be checking in for Hafner. Assuming she knocks in this.
Well, it'd be huge right here for the Red Devils. They could get a stop on the defensive side of the floor because there's 39 seconds left. So they're going to have time, barring if they give up an offensive rebound or anything like that. They're going to have time to get some more points before the end of this half. It'd be nice to be under a double-digit deficit going into halftime.
Red Devils forcing a turnover. 33 seconds exactly left. It was Holtz coming out off of that. So apologies for the misinformation, but Josie Ness onto the floor for Holtz instead. So Ness with it. Wilcox will set up the offense. Plenty of time for the Red Devils to run a set. Rosenberry down low. Ness. Ness, a power dribble, stops and flips it up and gets fouled. 19.4 seconds left in the second quarter. Ness, 6 points tonight, three fouls, and a bevy of rebounds as always. Coming into this game, Levi, Red Devils shoot about 61% as a team from the free throw line, and never fun to be leaving points at the line.
No, I mean, especially when you're getting to the end of halves, especially in the fourth quarter, you need free throws, and they start to add up at the end of the game. You can always go to the stat sheet and say, well, we missed points here, here, and here that we could have had. And a lot of times it can be the difference in a ball game.
8 seconds left. Earls from three, no good. Tipped up. Myers offensive rebound misses and fouled by Wilcox. Her second foul. A lot of foul trouble for the Red Devils tonight. Hafner with two, Ness with three. Now Ashley Wilcox with two as well. Colts will come in for Hafner. Tana Myers at the free throw line. Sophomore guard out of St. Louis, Missouri, shooting 65% on the season from the free throw line. Goes 2 for 2 there. 4 seconds left for the Red Devils. Holtz giving plenty of time and room. Three-pointer up from her. Oh, just spins out. It'll be Fontbonne taking an 11-point lead into halftime. Levi, this is a game the Red Devils were winning 21-20, and then Fontbonne flipped that on its head. And that's a, 16-4 run to close out this quarter.
And it was really the transition game that Fontbonne used to take the lead here in the first half. Eureka had a hard time getting back and stopping transition. They're going to have to do a better job of that in the second half if they want a chance to win this one.
That's all we have for you. First half coverage. On the other side of this, we've got second half coverage, but enjoy our halftime programming. Fontbonne leading 36-25 here at halftime.
College has given me the flexibility to pursue my passions and my interests, and I've recreated my identity for myself aside from just being an athlete.
My greatest personal discovery has been that I am capable of doing things that I didn't know I was capable of doing.
To be able to study what I wanted to and continue to play the sport I love, all of those things came together very nicely in one package in Division III.
Hi there. I'm Sean Sandrock, and I'm a sophomore here at Eureka College, studying political science and history with a pre-law emphasis and music vocal performance, and I'm going to be showing you around campus today. This is Burgess Street, which separates the academic and residential sides of campus. Let's begin our tour here at Dickinson Commons, which is one of our two eating establishments here on campus. It's set up like a food court style, which offers substations, a grill station, pizza, and even a home-cooked meal. We also offer lots of vegan and vegetarian options here on campus. This is Burgess Hall, which houses our social science and business classes. It also contains our professor's offices and student classrooms. Built in 1891, Burgess was originally our library, which since has moved across the street in 1967 to our new library. Did you know on the third floor of Burgess we have a new creative design lab, which is designated to all of our art students? This is Melick Library, which has many resources here on Eureka College's campus, including upstairs cubicles, the Gammon Room, which is a lounge area, downstairs classrooms, and the Ronald Reagan Archives. Did you know that President Reagan is a Eureka College alum? If you can't find your book here in the library, we're fortunate enough to be part of the iShare database, which consists of 90 libraries that will find your book and send it here. You may be wondering what classes are like here at Eureka. We usually have a student population of about 500 students, which allows for a lot of individualized attention in the classrooms. Our student to professor ratio is about 13 to 1, which allows students and professors to really get to know each other. We are now coming up on Benham Binkley on my left and Sanders on my right. Benham Binkley was built in 1917, right at the peak of World War I, and Sanders was added on in 2014 with the use of 100% donations given to the institution. This building was awarded Leadership in Energy Environmental Design, which focuses on Sanders being an eco-friendly structure. These buildings are classified as our math and science halls, which house classrooms, professors' offices, and a few science labs. This is Pritchard Theater, which was built right around the same time as Benham Binkley and was originally our sports complex here on campus. The main floor was the gym, and the basement was our swimming pool, where President Ronald Reagan swam as a freshman here on campus. This building is now used for our fine arts classes. Eureka College also played a role in World War II. Enrollment was down due to war efforts, and we were looking for a few new ways to bring in some cash. The college found a program where we could house Nazi German prisoners of war here in the United States. So Pritchard Theater became a holding place for prisoners of war where they would walk down the street during the day and work at the canning factory. The building behind me is the chapel, which is a very historical building here on campus. It is home to our music department. Downstairs includes classrooms, professors' offices, and practice rooms. Upstairs, you will find McAllister Hall, which is where many students perform today. This is the stage where Ronald Reagan gave his first ever speech on behalf of Eureka College's student body. This is the hall where President Reagan discovered his speaking ability. In his 1982 commencement address, he stated, "Everything that's been good in my life began here." Our oldest building behind me was built in 1858. Our administration building, Burris Dickinson, includes the president's office, the provost's office, the business office, alumni and development office, and some staff and professors' offices. If you look at this side of the building, you may notice some things when we reach the other side. Eureka College was founded in 1855 by a group of abolitionists that belonged to the Disciples of Christ Church. We are still associated with the Disciples of Christ Church, but we are now a multi-faith campus, and we welcome all here. Did you know that we were the first institution in Illinois and the third in the nation to admit men and women at an equal basis? Now, if you look at the opposite side of the building, besides the fire escape, you will notice that both sides are exactly the same. This building was here before the town of Eureka had even been established, so they didn't know which way the town was going to expand. So they decided to create two front entrances. This is the Ronald Reagan Peace Garden, dedicated to the life and legacy of President Ronald Wilson Reagan. You will see here a bust of President Reagan, as well as a significantly large piece of the Berlin Wall, which commemorates President Reagan challenging Mikhail Gorbachev to tear down this wall. The garden is a great place to chill out and enjoy the outdoor environment here on campus. Eureka College is the smallest institution to graduate a United States president, which goes to show that all students at Eureka can dream big and fulfill them. We're now looking at the Surf Center, where there are many resources useful for everyone, especially incoming students. This is the Ronald Reagan Museum, which holds over 10,000 artifacts of President Reagan's life here at Eureka. Some were even hand-selected by Reagan himself. The Surf Center also includes the Career Service Center, Becker Auditorium, the Office of Student Life, and our college bookstore. Our final stop in the Surf Center is our second eating establishment here on campus called the Burgoo, named after a stew. The Burgoo is set up more like a store or a restaurant, unlike Dickinson Commons. Some of the students' favorite meals here are cheese sticks, chicken wraps, and Starbucks coffee drinks. While we walk over to the residential side, some students who live close may be wondering, commute or not? About 40% of our students here at Eureka are commuters, which means that all parking on campus is free for all students. Built in 2012, Arnold Hall is our newest residence facility here on Eureka College's campus. These are our most spacious rooms on campus, which is nice when sharing it with a roommate. Arnold Hall consists of 5 wings that each house upper-class residents. Each wing has its own study lounge and larger social lounge with a TV. Every room on campus comes with a bed, chest, desk, bookcase, chair, and closet for each resident. Arnold houses 2 of the 3 sororities on campus. The rooms also include great Ethernet access and high-speed Wi-Fi, as well as geothermal heating and cooling. Arnold also includes a full kitchen and lots of additional lounge and study space, including a media room on the upper level that is perfect for group project work and has a printer free for student use. Behind me is Langston Hall, which is an upperclassman residence facility that offers suite-style living. Langston is co-ed by suite and is set up with 2 single-person rooms that share a toilet and shower in the middle, but have their own sinks in their rooms. It is convenient for upper-class students who would like to live in a quieter environment. Each floor in Langston has a large lounge area with a TV, study, and social space. The lobby area has a couple computers and a printer for student use. This is the Reagan Athletic Complex, dedicated to President Ronald Reagan and his older brother Neil, who also attended the college. Our gym is completely equipped with stadium chairs, which means every chair has a back. We are the only NCAA Division III school to have this luxury. Upstairs, a classroom, some event rooms, and many coaches' offices. The Bonatti Fitness Center is offered free to all students who would like to exercise using machines. Even commuter students have the access to this facility free of charge. Last in this building, our weight room, which is full of new equipment as of fall of 2019. Just outside the Reagan Athletic Complex, we have our football and soccer field, as well as our baseball and softball diamonds. The football and soccer field was converted into AstroTurf, and it also includes a Megatron. Here at Eureka College, we have many different athletic teams that compete throughout various times of the year. To my right is Founders Court, which is predominantly a freshman residence hall. Both of our freshman residence halls are set up to be limited occupancy so students can get to know each other and create a community value. Founders consists of four separate buildings that are all connected by stairwells: Darst, Deweese, Ford, and Myers. All of our residence halls have access to laundry areas that are free of charge for all students. Founders Court residents use Ben Major just next door for additional lounge space and a large laundry facility. We are now at Alumni Court, which also houses all incoming freshmen. These rooms are comfortably sized for two roommates. Be sure to check your packing list before you come to campus to see what items it is suggested that you bring and what items are not allowed on campus. Connecting both alumni residential buildings is our Learning Center, a great resource to use if you want help with writing or any course, or you could help here by becoming a tutor. The Learning Center is also a great place to study and is open 24/7 for student use. This is Ben Major, named after the man who owned all of the land that Eureka College now sits upon. This is a recreational building here on campus, which gives the students opportunities to chill out, play games, or even watch TV. To finalize our tour, behind me is Gunzenhauser Hall. It was built in 1929. It was extensively remodeled, but we strive to keep the 1920s look with the original wood floors, doors, and pedestal sinks. This concludes our tour here at Eureka College. For more information or to schedule a tour, please visit us online. We hope to see you soon.
I don't think that many kids in my son's school even do it.
He makes fun of his friend who vapes.
He would never try it.
She's into soccer.
She's on the honor roll.
She's just not the type.
No way.
No way.
No way. No way. My kid would never vape.
Get your head out of the cloud. Today, nearly 8,000 kids will start vaping. Maybe even yours. Learn about the dangers at talkaboutvaping.org.
Proportion to me is the lived experience of our Division III student athletes. They balance life from an academic perspective and the rigors of competing at a high level, bonding with teammates and building lifelong friendships. But they also are involved in their communities. They work jobs and internships and volunteer. They've learned to be resilient. Diverse experiences are setting them up for the future.
Passion's love. Passion is love for what you do. Because I think when you face challenges, it comes down to how much you want it and how much you love it. Passion is what keeps you going forward. Seeing so many people that were like-minded and so hardworking in their sport and academics, being surrounded by like-minded people makes you want to be more passionate. I think it pushes you to a different level that maybe you didn't think you had. And you can do the best of both worlds and love all of it.
A good citizen is someone who wants to make a positive impact both in their communities and in the world around them. The Division III approach is absolutely the best approach out there for amateur sport because it wants student athletes to explore all parts of who they are. Be successful in the classroom, be successful in competition, be successful in the community. So our student athletes learn what it means to strive for and attain success, but doing it the right way and being good citizens.
Comprehensive learning is being able to adapt to experiences and apply the things that I learned. Being an athlete and juggling academics helped me grow as a person, and things that I've learned, I was able to apply it in another field, putting them into everyday life. Developing comprehensive learning helped me prioritize certain things to make sure I get to where I want to be.
Responsibility is being accountable for your words and actions, first and foremost. It also is an obligation to be a positive influence in the communities around you. Being in a D3 program, you're going to have lots of different opportunities. You're not just an athlete, you're also involved in student life. Your academics are extremely important. We give a lot of our student athletes responsibilities right from the start by giving them leadership opportunities, by having them engage in the community, being a positive influence. That's being a responsible person.
I believe sportsmanship is it's a mutual admiration and respect for your fellow competitors. we all go through a lot to reach the point where we compete against one another. It's important to realize that. So once we're finally on the field or on the court or on the starting block, we look at each other as fellow human beings and not just competitors. Being able to recognize the hard work that other athletes are putting in creates a more positive and inclusive environment.
The black truck. Hey, Christina from accounting.
Yeah, hi.
Hey, I used to date a girl named Christina.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then she dumped me for my best friend. You want to see some photos of them that I took?
I don't.
I thought we talked about this, buddy.
Buzz and overshared again?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to call a car.
That's a smart idea.
So, yeah, I know. That's why I did it.
Hey, you're going to get back to the top of the mountain.
Does that mean I'm going to get back with Christina?
No.
Oh.
No.
I surrender.
All right, pal. Get ready for the day, buddy.
Hey, Dad. We have a gun.
What's that?
We have a gun.
...36-25, our score coming out of halftime. Fontbonne Griffins leading the Eureka Red Devils in their return to home. Home crowds certainly looking for a little bit more success in this half. Levi Taylor, Spencer Davis with you. I'm Spencer Davis, to clarify. Usually introduce myself first, but, you know, it's the way that today's gone sometimes. We are returning to action. Fontbonne starting on offense with Hannah Myers. Working on Bryn Holtz, back out Amaya Earls. Three-pointer up from her left short. Josie Ness, her first rebound of the second half.
We'll see how the Red Devils come out on offense in this half. Need to do a better job of moving the ball around. They create open shots, but just unfortunately unable to get them to fall. See if they can get some more shots to fall here in the second half.
Wilcox with a spin move, kicks out. Holtz firing from three, knocked in. Holtz with 11 in that first half. Now up to 14 on the night. Took 13 shots in that first half as well. Is not afraid to shoot.
No, not afraid to shoot at all. And she opens the scoring here in the second half. Getting a lot from her in this second half to get back into this ball game and hopefully come out on top.
Pickett looking to respond. Can't, off the backboard. And it's Harbor getting fouled. She will head to the free throw line. First foul for the Red Devils. And again, Levi, we talked about this in the first half. It's been a very tightly called game.
Yeah, especially on the perimeter. A lot of fouls called outside of the three-point line. And the Red Devils, unfortunately, you know, you can't give up offensive rebounds and give the offense an opportunity to score, you know, after two or three chances. You got to block out, get your body on somebody, move them out of the way. Because, I mean, second chance opportunity, you give them second, third chance opportunities, they're going to score on one of them.
Yeah, Fontbonne with six offensive rebounds in that first half. Red Devils fought back with five. So again, it's been pretty even in terms of second chance efforts, but it does seem like Fontbonne has capitalized the most off of it. It's 13 seconds left in the shot clock. It's Holtz. Step back. Can't knock that one in. Tipped away for a moment. Bailey has it. Bailey pitches back. Harbor settling with Pickett. It's Bailey on the cut over Seidel, and Seidel committing a foul. Coach Hedrick not too happy about that. Granted, I don't think many coaches are happy when any of their players pick up a foul. So
no, it's, I don't think it's something that they're necessarily jumping up and down about and celebrating, but those two quick ones on Seidel. She had the one on the offensive rebound on the last possession, and that one right there on a well-designed play from Fontbonne to get the cutter going to the basket.
The fourth Red Devil with multiple fouls tonight, joining Katie Hafner and Ashley Wilcox with two, and Josie Ness with three. Ness with that rebound there. It's rebound number six for her tonight. It's Wilcox. Going to get to the basket around Bailey. Cannot. Goes out Ness. Ness backing down Earls. Little elbow there. Banks in.
Well, Josie Ness in the post. I mean, how many times have we seen it? As Fontbonne turns the ball over right there, we'll get the ball back. But how many times have we seen Josie Ness in the post? She's got really good moves down in the post and creates, You know, sometimes I don't know how she does it, Spencer, to be honest with you. I don't know how she creates open shots for herself, but she does a very good job of using her body against the defender to create an open shot.
Rosenberry from three, no good. Offensive rebound there from Holtz. And then a tie-up. Possession arrow belonging to Eureka. Holtz out there for sure for her scoring, but also doing a great job on the boards as well. I believe that's her fifth rebound of the night as well. She had four at half.
Well, we talked about she's a six-foot guard. I mean, you can put her down there on defense. She plays in a guard position on offense. I mean, it's really helpful to have that.
Three-on-two break. Bailey with the left hand finishes. Lead back up to 11 for Fontbonne.
And this is kind of what we were seeing in the first half when Fontbonne started pulling away. A lot of coast-to-coast buckets, fast breaks, speeding Eureka up when they're not able to get back in transition defense.
Rosenberry, fairly quiet night from her so far. Only 2 points. She's in a double screen there. Rosenberry to the left side and finishes there. And again, that's going to be somebody that the Red Devils are going to rely on to pick up some of that scoring. Ball knocked away and it will go out of bounds.
Well, Rosenberry got the screen up top. And she must have heard you say that she only had 2 points because she wanted to change it. That's the announcer jinx going in our direction, in our favor that time.
I think that's probably, certainly my best skill is the ability to make the opposite of what I just said happen. There's Myers down low in the corner. One-handed pass gets deflected. Bailey five on the shot clock. Long three up, too strong, and a rebound for Earls. Bailey, we're going to drive, and a late foul call there on Holtz. Levi, I don't know about that one. I didn't see a whole lot of arm there.
Well, if anything, I agree with you. If anything, it must have been with the body because there definitely wasn't any contact up top.
That sure didn't seem like a lot of body contact either.
Well, I agree with you. I'm just saying that if they were going to call it on anything, I guess that must have been what it was, because there was, zero contact at the top.
9-point lead, offensive rebound leads to a Myers shot and Holtz another foul. That one, I will say, looked like a foul.
Yeah, I think they got the right call on that one.
41-32, Fontbonne in front. It's Holtz's third foul. And again, with four players on your bench, foul trouble is something that can really harm your attempts to come back.
Especially when one of your better players is playing with three right now, and they're a little bit risky with her in that first half. Could have picked up her fourth.
Myers a little too physical down low, and Holtz was quite animated after getting that call. A very animated player, I'll say. Certainly has fun after making a shot. Likes to get an explanation from officials as to where the call was. Which can't blame her for in the last one. Wilcox, tough finish there. Lead cut down to 7. It's Myers on the sideline trying to get around Holtz. Trap put on, able to escape. Pickett. Bailey, open look, Harbor run off the line. Nice find there, Pickett still working around. Shot up there, and Hafner with a foul on the three-point attempt. And wow, that's 5 team fouls on Eureka in 3 minutes and 46 seconds.
Yeah, definitely not the way that you want to start the half, because now Fontbonne is in the bonus, if I'm not mistaken. After 5 team fouls.
Nobody tell him. Okay, so we just became accomplices to the crime for not telling, but you know what? It's okay. 41-34. And a travel.
I've seen several travel calls tonight, Spencer. I mean, they're calling it tight, not only in the foul category, but with travels, carries, double dribbles, whatever. Yeah, I mean, I told Spencer in one of these breaks, you're not going to get away with anything. And now the official is talking to the scores table. I think that they're gonna send both teams to the bench, and they're gonna have a conversation.
They missed the bonus free throw. Scores table alerting that there was five on the Red Devils. I think this becomes a question of what do we do?
Yeah, do you add time to the clock? Like,
I don't know. I mean, not much time elapsed in that span. It was a pretty quick travel, I think. But again, yeah. I mean, it gives you a free timeout. They've got another one coming up in about a minute as well. But again, Levi trailing by seven. It feels like this can be a Red Devil game, but they're missing something. Do you have any ideas of what it is?
Well, I think it starts with, first off, taking care of the ball. Everything starts there. You got to take care of the ball, have good offensive possessions. And then another thing that it starts with is playing defense. We've talked several times tonight about Eureka is not stepping in front of ball handlers. They're kind of letting their ball handlers get deep into the lane, and that creates a lot of opportunities with pass-offs, wide-open layups, things like that. And then also, on top of that, it forces you to get into foul trouble because you're getting out of position, and then you've got to make up for it. And most of the time, you end up committing a foul. So I think take care of the ball, step up on defense and stop the transition buckets, and get in a hand in the face on the perimeter. And if you can do that, and start controlling the boards, you got a good chance to put yourself in a position to win this ball game. But I mean, it's got to start now, because we're going to start getting into the later portion of this ball game, and you got to slow this momentum down now before it starts to really pick up.
And wanting to make sure that your defense remains intense is a hard thing to kind of instill when it's like, all right, we have to be as intense as possible, but also you have three fouls, don't get another one. So they are going to shoot these bonus free throws. Scores table betraying us. How could they do this?
We tried.
We got away with it for a minute.
Yeah, we did it. We did our part, Spencer. We didn't tell them nothing.
Surely no one at the broadcast or has the broadcast pulled up down there. That'd be unfortunate. What if we really did? I think somebody at the book finally caught it. First free throw knocked in, and as the saying goes, ball doesn't lie. 6:07 remaining in the third. Levi, they didn't add any time on there. I guess it's kind of difficult to estimate how much came off on that play before the travel.
Yeah, I mean, it was such a little amount of time that elapsed. I mean, we were not talking like a minute or anything. It was just a few seconds before the travel occurred.
Seidel can't finish on the reverse.
It was a good backdoor cut, and this is really what we've been talking about. Good backdoor cut, good pass to finder, just unfortunately not able to get the shot to fall, and that's kind of been the story for the Red Devils offense in this game.
8-point lead for Fontbonne. It's Earls and Holtz getting away with it there. Everything that's been called, and that doesn't. I don't. It's one of those days. All the way to the bucket, can't finish. Good no call there. 3-on-4 break. Wilcox jump stop into the corner. Rosenberry. Excuse me, that's Holtz knocking in a three. 5-point lead for Fontbonne after the three from Eureka. It's Bailey. Red Devils back in the 2-3 zone. Myers looking to drive. Good hands there from Seidel. I believe that'll take us to our media timeout as well. Langenberg in. Maybe not a media timeout this time. We go with the flow here at ECTV. 42-37. Fontbonne leading. Langenberg freshly back into the game. Has it. And a little too strong on that pass. We'll see if we go this time.
Well, I mean, in the first two quarters they did, but maybe not following that trend here in the second half. I'm a little confused. Okay.
We like to live in uncertainty here. But it is a 5-point lead for Fontbonne. Eureka looking to cut into it. Seidel, 3-pointer, no good. Ness doing a good job of just going straight up to try to knock that out.
Maybe a little bit of a rush shot there. Maybe can start to smell the blood in the water a little bit. You know, this is the tightest this game has been in a while. Maybe getting a little antsy.
Wilcox, a little sloppy on the closeout, picking up a foul. And that'll also send Fontbonne to the line. there is the media timeout. 4:27 left in the third quarter. 42-37, Fatbon leading. You're watching Eureka College Basketball on ECTV.
Responsibility is being accountable for your words and actions, first and foremost. It also is an obligation to be a positive influence in the communities around you. Being in a D3 program, you're going to have lots of different opportunities. You're not just an athlete, you're also involved in student life. Your academics are extremely important. We give a lot of our student athletes responsibilities right from the start by giving them leadership opportunities, by having them engage in the community, be a positive influence. That's being a responsible person.
What would you give for a child you loved to make their wish come true? To help them fight a critical illness? Just imagine what you'd do. Every single one of us can make the stars align. Because when we come together, hope and joy will shine.
Both teams returning to the floor. It's a five-point lead for Fatbon. The Red Devils, again, offensively have looked a lot better in this half, but still waiting for that defensive intensity. Again, that's something else we talked about, the foul trouble that a lot of these, I was going to say guards or posts, but it's really both. It's hard to maintain that level of intensity and being as aggressive as you can be in those passing lanes or near the basket.
Yeah, it really does play a factor. I mean, it's always in the back of your mind. Well, not even necessarily the back of your mind. Sometimes on the front of your mind. When you're in foul trouble, you feel like you can't play as intensive defense. But a way to combat that is just get in good position and stay in front of your person and force yourself to not have to play defense with your hands. And that way, they're going to have to go through you, and it'll be an offensive foul in that case.
Quick break. It's Myers, Hafner trying to chase her down. Good finish. Lead up to 7 for the Griffins. Rosenberry working on Langenberg, getting a screen from Holtz. She has it now. Down low, Chisholm calling for it. Post touch, can't finish. It'll be 2 shots for the senior from Pekin. 3:50 left in the third quarter.
Well, once again, right there, we talked about it as being called very tight. If I'm a Fatbon fan, I'm saying, hey, I felt like that was a clean defensive play, but nevertheless, it's a foul call.
But as Eureka fans will point out, that we've had 7 fouls called us in this quarter.
Correct. Correct.
We had 5 in the first 4 minutes. So let's not go to war over this. Other battles to be faced. It's again reduced down to a 5-point lead. It's been kind of the way that things have gone recently. Again, Eureka had leads at certain points in that first quarter, early second quarter, and then Fatbon went on a huge run. Now it's been the Red Devils trying to fight back into this one. It's Langenberg, 15 on the shot clock. Myers, gonna drive around Ness, floater up, might have been blocked. Hopkins, 8 seconds on the shot clock. Earl's a running start. 3 seconds on the shot clock. Myers blocked once again by Ness, and it'll land on the baseline, and they're going to call it a shot clock violation.
Well, I'm surprised that this official out here made that call, because he doesn't have a view of the baseline. I feel like that would be the baseline official's call, because he sees when the ball goes out of bounds. There could have been still time left. But again, I'm not going to say anything because it's our ball now. But
jump ball call.
I take it back.
Been the storyline, Levi, is just turnovers at not great points in the game. It's these momentum spots where the Eureka just can't quite capitalize. And trying to get this back into a one-possession game would be massive, but they really just can't get past this five-point buffer, it seems. 3:03 left in the third. It's Bailey. Kicks out. Three-pointer up. Myers. No good. Wilcox tracking down the rebound. A good outlet there from Ariel Chisholm, 1-on-2. Chisholm through some contact. Bucket is good.
Well, we talked about Eureka literally just a few seconds ago needing a momentum play to make this a one-score game. And that's a pretty big momentum play getting it to a one-score game, has a chance to make it a two-point game if this free throw goes down. And getting here nearing the end of this third quarter, if you can take this momentum into the fourth quarter and gain a lead, it does a lot for your team.
Lead cut down to three for the time being. And make it two after the three-point play for Ariel Chisholm. Red Devils right back into their press. Good trap put on by Hopkins, able to escape it. Beamer, nice pass up. And the finish by Harbor.
Well, it's been the story all night. Fonbon does a really good job against that press. They did a great job right there breaking it.
Bailey and Wilcox going at it on the perimeter. Rosenberry, nice spin move, able to get to the middle of the lane and took a shoulder check. It'll be the fourth team foul on Fonbon. It's a little surprised there wasn't any call with Wilcox and Bailey originally, just with how tight it's been called on the defense. And then, obviously, Coach Fitzgerald wants a foul call on the push-off, but with as much contact being put out there, I don't think you can call one way or the other on that.
I think it was a good no call. I feel like there was contact both ways, and there was nothing really that you could call.
Tafner trying to get a start. Can't. Bailey taking away, and Ness knocking it out of bounds. Will not be a foul on Josie Ness, but
very fortunate that it wasn't a foul on Josie Ness. Very easily could have been a foul call. And that, as we've mentioned, would have been her fourth in a very, very crucial part in this ball game. She needs to be on the floor as much as possible.
Four-point lead for Fontbon. Try to get across half court. Harbor able to do so. It's Beamer. Hopkins. All Harbor. 2:01 left in the third. 17 on the shot clock. Beamer bounce pass to Bailey. She hit a deep three earlier. Hasn't really shot a lot from there since. Earls unsuccessful in that attempt. Wilcox into the middle of the floor for the Red Devils. Trying to find Ness down low. Able to find her eventually. Double team down there. Finds Hafner cutting the bucket. Hafner contact. Bucket is good once again.
Why? Couple of huge momentum plays coming for the Red Devils here late in this third quarter. I mean, Spencer, they're trying to come back into this game. They're trying to make an effort. Need to tighten up a little bit defensively, and if they do that, they're going to be in a great position to win this ball game. Their offense is starting to come alive. They're starting to put things together. Got to have free throws, though.
1:32 left in the third quarter. Two-point lead for Fontbon. Red Devils trying to erase an 11-point deficit at halftime. All in one quarter, mind you. It's Earls working around Bailey. 12 on the shot clock. Chisholm on the floor, away from the play. Bailey, scoop shot, up and in. Jamise Bailey, leading scorer for Fontbon tonight and the season. Making sure her team stays alive. Rosenberry, the drive from the corner. It's Hafner, a little pump fake. Tried to sneak a pass to get a kick ball instead.
It was the right idea from Hafner. Shoot, Josie Ness had great position on the opposite block. And had that foot not been there, probably would have been a 2 points for the Red Devils.
I was a kickball merchant back in the day. That's what I tried to do. I wasn't very good at staying in front of people, but you know, I could kick the ball pretty well to make sure the play stopped. Ness to the corner, Hafner. 12 on the shot clock. Tried to find Wilcox. A little too aggressive, I think, on that particular pass.
Yeah, that was a forced pass. Probably could have still had over 10 seconds left on the shot clock. Could have looked for something else.
Wilcox into Ness. Ness around Bailey. Can't finish. Gets her own miss. Goes up again, and she's fouled that time. Two shots for Josie Ness.
Well, I was about to say, Spencer, that's a rare miss from Josie Ness that we see when she's on the low block, but was able to get her offensive rebound and now has an opportunity to make up for it at the line.
No guaranteed plays in basketball. Sometimes you just miss the shots you usually make. .2 seconds left in the third quarter. Fadbine looking for their second win in 2024. Red Devils looking for their first. 0 for 2 on that trip, and a foul on Hafner going the other way. It's Hafner's fourth foul, and it'll send Fadbine to the free throw line. Excuse me, they attribute that to Chisholm. Apologies, that's her first. One of the few Red Devils with zero or one foul. Bailey up to 17 points tonight. She has four fouls. So maybe something that the Red Devils can kind of attack going into the fourth quarter and the end of the third. Missed there and a rebound from Josie Ness. 5-point lead back in effect. Chisholm pass gets deflected. About a 10 to 11 second difference between shot and game clock. Red Devils with plenty of time. Rosenberry kicks to the corner. Hafner. Ness over on Beamer and a charge drawn there.
Well, might have sold it a little bit, but is a correct call. Josie Ness lowered her shoulder. And they're going to, I mean, if the offensive player lowers their shoulder, and they're going to call it every time as an offensive foul.
Especially when there's a guard on you as a forward. That was also what I was very good at. Capitalizing on a mismatch there. The Red Devils thought they were capitalizing on a mismatch there. It's Beamer looking to drive, trying to return the favor, misses the layup. 2 seconds left. Holtz going around the back. Long shot left short. 49-44 will be our score at the end of three. Back and forth battle between Fadbine and Eureka. Eureka still looking to get a win in the last five. You're watching Eureka College Basketball right here on ECTV.
When people ask us who we are, we tell them we're problem solvers, opportunity creators, community builders, and change makers. We are Rotary. Around the world, our network of 1.4 million neighbors, friends, and leaders volunteer their skills, expertise, and resources to solve issues and address community needs. We are people of action. Join us, and together, we can make an even greater impact. Find out how you can get involved at rotary.org/action.
.44 Fadbine leading Eureka. The fourth quarter of action is about to begin. Spencer Davis, Levi Taylor with you. Levi, Eureka winning that third quarter 19-13. And again, only trailing by five now.
Yeah, I mean, really got the offense going in that second half. Need some more of that here in this fourth quarter. Still got some work to do. Let's see how they open it up right here.
It's Ashley Wilcox and the Red Devils on offense to start. Rosenberry driving from the corner. Good backdoor find. Wilcox in the mid-range. No good. Rosenberry an offensive rebound. And the first foul comes 15 seconds into the fourth quarter.
And not really surprised to see it. That's kind of been the story tonight. A lot of foul calls in this one so far.
Wilcox to the bucket, fouled, and she'll shoot two. It's a Laker Shaq type performance. Getting a lot of calls tonight. Both teams, regardless, doesn't feel unfair on either side, but certainly a lot of whistles. The Ashley Wilcox taking the free throws.
And Spencer, we've talked about free throws a little bit in this game. They're going to be very, very important, especially in this fourth quarter. You need to make sure that you're cashing in at the line to give your team the best opportunity to win this game.
Red Devils back within one possession. Throwing on their press immediately. Fadbine has done well with the press for the most part. There have been a couple of blips, but handling it well, especially right there. Bailey And Ness, again, that's going to be something else we have to watch. Ness and Bailey both with four fouls.
And you saw right there that Ness just really threw her hands up. There wasn't much that she could do. Playing with four fouls, and probably smart to do that because she knows that they're going to need her going down this stretch. There's 2 points from her right there.
Also, apologies. I had the wrong foul total on the scoreboard. Two fouls for Jamise Bailey. Pretty large difference. It was showing four, I promise. Tip pass there from Rosenberry, still with Fontbon. Holtz with her fourth foul in that. It's a tough day to be a defender today.
Yeah, I mean, just doing the best that they can. Just the only thing I can really say is beat your person to the spot and get in front of them. That's really all you can do. Because if you shuffle alongside of them or anything like that, they're going to call a foul on you.
Bailey from three, too strong. Rebound tipped and ends up with Ness. Seidel pushing the pace for the Red Devils. Holtz. Three-pointer up from her. Rattles out. A rebound for Pickett. Fontbon back in their track shoes. Holtz went down and finished by Jamise Bailey. You could tell that Holtz was hoping that there would be contact, so she would draw a foul call there. Five-point lead again for the Griffins. Wilcox. It's called for a charge. Levi, is that the second time there's been a charge call and the player hasn't gone down?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it's not really something that you see very often. Really, I don't understand how that's a charge call because the defender did not have position. There was nothing about that, Spencer, that told me that that was a charge.
Actually, I have one thing that tells me it was a charge. The official. Huh? That's who makes the decision, and I guess there was enough down there. Maybe floor level, it looks different. Looked like a pivot feet got switched there too, but shot was missed. Holtz, nice behind the back to lose Bailey for a moment. Dribbling into that corner, firing from her spot. Misses that shot, Pickett rebound. 7:45 to go in the fourth, 5-point lead. It's Pickett. It's Harbor. Trying to work on Hafner. Myers. Baseline drive, cross court, Pickett three-pointer high. Archer once again, too strong off the backboard. Wilcox up the floor quickly, Holtz.
Smart to bring that one out and set up the offense. Did not have numbers there. It would have been not a very smart decision to dribble into the defense.
Good find there from Bailey. Pickett having some problems bringing it in. Shot goes up. Good no call. That would have been Holtz's fifth. Going to slow things down. Bailey, a lot of pressure there. Wilcox going to go to the bucket. Foul. Bucket is good.
Really surprised that one wasn't called on the floor. Definitely looks like it was not during the shot, but we'll take it.
Three ticks under seven. Left in regulation. 53-50, Fontbon up. Ashley Wilcox, the freshman at the free throw line for the Red Devils. Again, Levi, you said it a few times now, those trips to the free throw line start to loom very large in that fourth quarter and you're trailing by change. Good bounce pass into the post and a nice finish there for Hannah Myers. Lead back up to five. Rosenberry trying to get around Pickett all the way to the glass. High pass, Bailey able to bring it in. Red Devils trying to trap near half court. Bailey losing her defenders. Three-pointer up from Harbor, too strong. And a holding call on Ashley Wilcox. That is her fifth. This is where that depth or lack of depth for the Red Devils is going to come into play. Now with only three players remaining on the bench. And Ness having four fouls and Holtz having four fouls as well. Nineteen seconds on the shot clock. Bailey, top of the key three from her. Another chance for Fadbon Myers. Good hands from Holtz. Even on a play like that, Levi, you see Holtz not even going for the ball on the ground because
She just watched
the fifth.
Just watched her teammate pick up her fifth foul by going for a ball on the floor.
Myers, three-pointer up, left short, did not touch rim. Pickett, shot clock expired. Good defensive possession. I don't know if good defensive possession. A couple of offensive rebounds were conceded there, but at the end of the day, the defense did get the last stop. Longer possession than they would have liked, I imagine.
Going to need to clean that up, especially coming down the stretch. Cannot be giving them second chances to score, especially in a tight ball game like this.
Wilcox able to find Hafner and a bunny there for the Red Devil offense.
Really good pass off from Rosenberry. As I'm pretty sure that ball touched the line, but no call.
3-on-2 break. Harbor off the glass and in. Lead back up to 3. And Levi, this is the type of pace that does not benefit the Red Devils in any way.
No, I mean, we saw Fonbon kind of blow this game open in the second quarter by playing like this and using this style and speeding the Red Devils up.
Sub onto the floor. It's Brianna Beamer. Fonbon, 57-54, the current score. And they're going to take a media timeout here at 5:14 in the fourth quarter. 57-54, Fonbon leading here in Eureka. Red Devils trying to mount a comeback on ECTV.
Well, I'm just trying to keep things running for those who rely on us. That's why we don't have time to be sick with the flu.
We don't have time for delays.
Ready!
We don't have time for spills.
Next.
We don't have time for setbacks. Let's be real.
Getting the flu shot
helps you fight the flu.
Get a flu shot for yourself and those around you too.
Last week, Brandon met a girl on a dating app. One day after work, he finally found the courage to ask her out. No answer. He started to panic. Was he being too pushy? Maybe it was too...
Hey, sorry I didn't respond. I was driving. I would love to go on a date. How does tonight sound?
Brandon tried to play it cool, but inside he knew. A girl so smart, so responsible. She must be a keeper.
...57-54, the current score, Fonbon leading. Looking for their second slack win of the season. The Red Devils looking for their third. 5:07, our final media timeout, having been completed. Good trap there in the short corner. It's Bailey trying to get away from it, ball on the floor. Earl's able to pick it up. It's Myers trying to go through Holtz, and a foul called. Goes on Avery Seidel with a push from behind. And Levi, having the angle on this, maybe there was a, I guess Coach Hedrick took a timeout earlier. This is the media timeout. Apologies. 57-54, Fonbon leading. Levi, we'll stay for this one, I guess. Fun part about basketball, sometimes you don't really know what's going on.
Yeah, that foul call was pretty confusing. I mean, he called it from the opposite side of the floor. He didn't even have an angle on it. He was blocked by players. Honestly, from up here, we had a better angle at that than he did, and he still called the foul. Definitely thought it was a travel. But, I mean, that's kind of been the story in this ball game, is just kind of chintzy fouls, if you will.
Take ECTV with you wherever you go. ECTV is now available on the all-new EC Connect app. Download the app from the Google Play or Apple App Store. Once you open it, you can click on ECTV to watch us on your smartphone. You can also find our sister station, WEUR. Download the all-new EC Connect app right now. play, getting ready to resume. It's a three-point lead for Fontbonne, and I feel like a broken record saying that. It's been a 3-5-point lead for the majority of this second half. But again, the largest storyline of the game is foul trouble. The Red Devils and Fontbonne both with a lot of players, 3 or 4 fouls. It's Myers handing off Beamer. Back out, Myers, three-pointer up from her, no good. Good box outs all around by the Red Devils. Ness trying to evade Earls. Shoulder check allowed all the way down the sideline there. Hafner able to find Ness on the roll. Ness, good finish. We always like to say Levi the Loch Ness Monster. It's hard to stop her when she gets close to the bucket. Hafner picking off that pass and... Travel is the call. Said Hafner did have possession on her feet originally before going to the floor.
I mean, if that's the case and that's the correct call, I just don't feel like that was what really happened.
Coach Hedrick did not agree either. Again, it's rare to find a coach that's like, you know what, that was the correct call in crunch time. Bailey, three-pointer up. Usually it's the opposite coach saying that. Team that didn't get the foul call. Rosenberry in transition, able to find Ness. Good ball movement on that break. Ness, free look again, didn't quite see it. Able to dump off, and a foul called.
What? I think she thought that there was somebody on her when there wasn't anybody really in the vicinity of her. She could have scored very easily. It really looked like she was confused on where the defenders were.
I don't blame her. I mean, most of the time she's double-teamed in the post, and that time she caught it, and nobody was around her. And scores table trying to flag somebody down. I don't know what for. .357 remaining in the fourth quarter. Fontbonne leading by a single point. Conversation being had there at the scorer's table. Levi, again, we've talked about how the pace of play has really been the storyline in this game. The Red Devils doing a good job of when they're limiting the pace of play, they're certainly dominating, but as soon as it gets towards a transition type of action, it's all Fontbonne.
And it really feels like in the second half, it's kind of been a back and forth of Eureka controlling the pace to Fontbonne controlling the pace, and it's been going back and forth. And as you said, when... That was a moonshot that bounced out for Holtz. That thing almost touched the rafters. I can't believe that went in, Spencer.
Cleanest splashes you'll ever see on a three-pointer off of that. Red Devils back in front by 2. It's their first lead since the early second quarter. Good hands from Hafner to poke it loose. Bailey with a double dribble. 3:33 left in the fourth. I can't believe that 3 went in.
I mean, I was in the middle of saying something. I don't even remember what I was talking about, if I'm being honest with you. That blew my mind. I have no idea how that went in.
Ness walking up the floor, guarded by Earls. Seidel. Beamer guarding her. Trying to get a screen from Holtz. Able to get around Beamer to the bucket. Misses the layup. Hafner's got to be careful there. Bailey able to get past Seidel to the corner. Beamer, three-pointer for the lead. Left short, Holtz rebounds. See Coach Hedrick asking his team to slow down. They don't have to push this. High-quality look gets you a 2-possession lead.
Yeah, right now you're not only playing against Fontbonne, but you're playing against the clock. You need to wind the clock down. Be smart with your possessions. Don't take shots early in the shot clock that you don't need to take.
59-57, Josie Ness to the free throw line. Onto the court, it's Riley Pickett. Yeah. 3-point lead for the Red Devils. And Levi, correct me if I'm wrong, I think this is the largest lead the Red Devils have had all night.
I believe you're correct. I mean, we're talking about at the end of the first quarter, this game was 14-11 in favor of Fontbonne, and now 61-57 for the Red Devils.
It was an 11-point deficit for the Red Devils at halftime. Again, like you said, commanding a 4-point lead late into this one. Pickett, free run to the bucket. And again, there's that four fouls with Josie Ness. Can't really put too much resistance on that.
And they're smart to attack her and go after her because they know that she can't be as aggressive on defense as she usually is, being in foul trouble.
Rosenberry kicks out. Seidel, best look from 3-4 all night, misses. Poked around, and a tie-up there from Hafner and Beamer. Possession arrow stays, though, with Fontbonne.
That's a really scrappy play there, that goes underlooked a lot of times. Because now, the next time there's a jump ball, it's Eureka's ball.
It's four fouls apiece. Any fouls committed from here is going to be bonus time. .216 left in the fourth quarter. Red Devils trying to get into that sixth spot that would earn them a spot in the SLIAC tournament later on in the year. Beamer onto the wing. Harbor. It's called for a travel on that. Costly turnover late in the game. .61-59. Michaela Rosenberry across half court. Bailey guarding her. It's Holtz. Open look from three to maybe ice it. Can't. A triple rebound there. Bailey breaking. Bailey, nice take to the bucket to tie at 61.
Well, it hurts when both your defenders that are back are Holtz and Ness, both with four fouls who can't really do much.
Rosenberry responds. You go back up two. 1:35 and a timeout taken by Fontbonne. And I don't think Fontbonne wanted a timeout. I'm confused. Both guys just signaled. Both coaches signaled that one wanted and one didn't, and the refs pointed to the other bench. 63-61, Red Devils taking the lead here on that Michaela Rosenberry layup. Levi, it's been a game with everything.
Yeah. As much as a lot of fouls, a lot of turnovers, big deficits, lead changes. If you want it, watch this game. It's going to have it. I mean, it's been a really it's been a back and forth ball game in a sense, but not really, if you understand what I mean. The pace of play has been back and forth, as we talked about earlier in this quarter. When Fontbonne's controlling the pace of play and speeding things up, they have a clear advantage. When Eureka is able to slow things down and control the ball, they have a clear advantage. So it's really been back and forth in that sense, if you will. But it's really been, outside of the second quarter, it's been a tightly contested ball game. And I think we're coming down to an exciting finish here in this last minute and a half.
Also, again, both teams at four fouls. Any foul committed is bonus free throws. And again, we talked about missed free throws. I think as early as the first quarter, you said missed free throws are the ones that look at you in the fourth quarter and you wish you had. I think both teams are looking at that kind of problem right now. Minute 34 left. Fontbonne looking to retie or reclaim the lead. Pickett to the corner. Beamer. Red Devils in the 2-3 zone once again. Minute 25, driving is Harbor to the basket, can't finish. Earl's bucket is good. Give it to Katie Hafner. And it's Amaya Earls with a chance to put the Griffins back in front.
And to note, that is also Hafner's fourth. So now three Red Devils on the floor with four fouls.
The Holtz pushing the pace. We'll get to the lane. The dream shake there. Misses the shot. It's Bailey. Pickett. You can tell, again, Fontbonne wants to be at this type of pace. Harbor from three. No. And Ness a rebound. Coach Hedrick trying to signal his ball handler to slow down. Able to get Michaela Rosenberry's attention. looking to go to the lane. Tried to go down low. Ball gets deflected. And a foul committed. That will be foul number five. Hold is the verdict. Goes on Avery Seidel, her fourth.
So now four Red Devils on the floor with four fouls.
But Kayla Rosenberry doesn't have any, though. So that's good.
Yeah. If anybody's going to foul, it's...
Hopefully her. Big free throws on the way for Riley Pickett. First one knocked in. 45.9 left. Again, our first of two games tonight. The men will tip off about 25 minutes after the conclusion of this. A 30-second timeout taken by Coach Hedrick. 65-63. Fontbonne leading. Quick break from us on ECTV.
Team Jude affects all corners of the world for good. I mean, if you think about organizations that affect an entire world, it's a short list. Taking care of kids is a priority. Taking care of the families as whole.
Without donations, without people that care for St. Jude and for the kids at St. Jude, our max wouldn't be here.
You are making a difference, not just in a hospital, but in an entire world.
2-point lead for Fontbonne with 45.9 seconds left. Again, the Red Devils led by four at one point in this fourth quarter. Fontbonne with a 6-point swing, and Levi, I think it comes down to that pace of play again.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like we're beating a dead horse, you know, talking about it, but it has really been the key factor in this ball game is whoever is controlling the pace has a clear advantage in this game.
Yeah, I think the issue with the dead horse, if you will, is that these narratives have been around since the first quarter. We figured this out pretty early on, and it's just whatever team's able to control it is how it's being solved. Holt, step back three,
up and in! 1-point lead for the Red Devils.
32 seconds left. Harbor to Earls, down low working on Holt's. Open look from Pickett, and the three is missed. And Ness with a rebound. Seidel goes to the floor and a jump ball. Still Red Devil basketball, but mercy.
Yeah, she got
hammered.
Gang tackled.
Coach Harbaugh would be proud of that one.
Yeah, I mean, good pursuit of the ball. Good job tracking her down to make the tackle, I guess. But my goodness, I can't believe that wasn't a call to foul by everything that's been called a foul tonight.
Precedent is being undone is what I think the call is. And a quick foul there from Bailey. That'll be Josie Ness going to the free throw line. They say no time has elapsed, but, like, surely we can take it down a couple hundredths of a second. You think it's being tedious, but listen. Couple hundredths of a second, a couple tenths of a second. And that is actually what they're doing. Well, except they added 19 minutes to the clock, but the effort's there. You're trying to figure it out. Two clock operators beefing with each other.
They'll get it.
66-65, Red Devils on top. It's Josie Ness waiting to take two free throws. And, man, this feels like icing the kicker. A lot of time to ponder what you're about to do. Let's just get the handheld clock at this point, this late in the game. 19.5 will be the verdict. So 3/10 of a second elapsed. Lead will hold at one.
Well, you talked about quote-unquote icing the kicker. Probably did have an effect on that free throw right there. And, I mean, free throws have been something that we've talked about all night long, Spencer.
And that one missed as well. Rosenberry kept it alive for a moment, and it's off of the hands of Fontbonne. Timeout taken by Fontbonne. Coach Fitzgerald not agreeing with the verdict on who that went off of, but Levi, this is... Also, we'll turn into a timeout fest real quick.
Oh, yeah. this is the, and it's going to turn into a foul fest as well. If you know that the Red Devils don't really have too many players that have a foul to give.
Yeah, in terms of people you want shooting free throws late in this game, nobody's shooting above 70% on the team. Ashley Wilcox, the highest percentage on the team at 67.6. But again, she's one of the players with four fouls. You'd hate to see her pick up a foul late. Actually, be Eureka on offense here, too.
Ashley Wilcox is done. She has five.
Correct. Sorry, I just assumed everybody had four at this point. But no, so Josie Ness, Katie Hafner, Bryn Holtz, and Avery Seidel, all with four fouls. But it'll be the Red Devils on offense, and it looks like they're going to try this handoff play again. And a hard foul there.
That's intentional, dude.
That was intentional. And it was a two-handed shove in the back. I understand trying to foul, but as a player, you have to make it seem not intentional. You're intentionally fouling, but you're not.
Yeah, you're yeah. That was
a two-handed shove in the back. Is
yeah, that was pretty blatant.
I think a hug would have sufficed.
Yeah.
Or just a slap on the back or something, but we'll see. Ness again at the free throw line, 0-for-2 on the last trip. Wanting to go this just down to the wire as possible. That one missed as well, and a rebound for Bailey. Timeout taken by Fontbonne, as we would expect. 66-65. The Red Devils leading by one. Here on the home court again, Levi. Red Devils, their last win was here at home against Blackburn. And that game was not nearly as close as this one.
No. I believe that we called that one together as well, actually. But I want to talk about this intentional foul down here because it may not seem like it's a big deal, the difference. But if that's called an intentional foul, Eureka gets two free throws and they get the ball back. And that's a huge difference. Now Fontbonne's got the ball with 16 seconds left and an opportunity to, if they score, take the lead in this game. So that the difference in that foul call right there really plays a big part in how this game is going to end.
Also, Fontbonne gets to advance the ball with that timeout. So getting the ball on their side of half court with 16.4 seconds left. Spencer Davis and Levi Taylor with you. Looking forward to bringing the end of this one to you. Hopkins able to catch it down low. Shot up over Holtz. Gets her own miss. Kicked out. Bailey from three up and in. Red Devils trailing by two now. Holtz trapped in the backcourt. They do have a timeout. Electing not to use it. Rosenberry at half court from half court. And it's too strong. And Fontbonne survives. 68-66. It's Jamise Bailey with the late three to put him over the top.
Yeah, on that play, Spencer, all the action was down in the paint. So all of our defenders were crashed in and focused on that and really weren't paying attention to anybody beyond the arc. Unfortunately, was able to get a pass out there and knock it down for Fontbonne. A really clutch shot from Bailey to give Fontbonne the win.
Yeah, she finishes with 26 points and no points bigger than that three she just hit. And a tough pill to swallow for the Red Devils. They fall to 4-10 on the season and 2-5 in SLIAC play. Whereas it goes to 2-5 now for Fontbonne as well. So both teams now going to be tied. They'll have another matchup later on in the year at Fontbonne. But again, a heartbreaker here for the Red Devils. Not the last time you'll hear from us tonight. The Red Devils take on Fontbonne in the men's edition of this matchup in about 25 minutes. It's again 68-66. Fontbonne taking it on behalf of our entire crew and my broadcast partners. Levi Taylor, this is Spencer Davis. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you in 25.